That's our cue to stand. Two, three. Stand up for Jesus,
ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is
to the services of the Salado Church of Christ. It's great to see everyone out with us this morning, and what a beautiful day God has given us to come together and worship. And what a true blessing that we have to be here. If you're a visitor, and it looks like we do have a few with us, we want to let you know that we're really happy to have you with us this morning, and each time that you have an opportunity to be back with us, we sure invite you to come back and be with us again. I've been asked to bring up a couple of points too for those that are visitors, and maybe for those members that forgot. For our communion, we use these little cups, and if you don't have one, if you'd raise your hand, we'll make sure you get one if you need one. Also, if you're a visitor, there's a little white card on the back of the pews. If you'll take one of those and fill it out so we'll have a record of your attendance, we'd appreciate that. To get our worship started this morning, as a kind of a call to worship, I'd like to read from Psalm 100, where we read, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name, for the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." Let's pray. Our Father, we come to you now, acknowledging you as the only true and living God. We're so thankful that we have the freedom to assemble here with our brothers and sisters and to worship you, because we know that around the world, even today and even at this moment, there are Christians that are being persecuted and are suffering just for being identified as a Christian. So as we go into this service this morning, we pray that you would help us to clear our minds and of our worldly concerns and thoughts, and help us to focus our hearts and minds on praising you and honoring you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad, and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to full at his command.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the images of gold you have set up." That was Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18.
The shadow of You know, at this time, we set aside to partake of the Lord's Supper. We call it a memorial. The question I want to ask is, why do we need a memorial? Yesterday was a memorial. I think most of us probably are quite aware of it, probably maybe got involved in something on television or maybe even in the community. What happened 20 years ago was horrific, and it really shook us up. We hopefully learned important lessons, but we need to remember. However, we tend to forget. You know, when God created us, He gave us an amazing body. Our brains in particular are so complicated. We're only just starting to learn how it works. You know, we know which regions are responsible for smell and touch and all that kind of stuff, and we've learned a tremendous amount. But there's a whole lot more we don't know about our brains, our minds, than what we do know. So the question is, what about memories? That's one of the most mysterious things of all. Where are our memories? Where are they stored? How are they stored? How many can you store? You know, we really don't know. I mean, that's still an area we know very little about. But what we do know is that most of our memories, we have so many. Most of them are discarded, or they're set aside, and we don't remember. But we keep the ones that, hopefully, that are most important to us. And maybe we keep some we shouldn't keep. I'm sure we do, or we don't want to. But one thing is, we do know, our ability to control our memories is horrible, very unreliable. So God Himself decided we needed reminders. You know, in the Old Testament, the rainbow was a reminder given about a super eventful. You know, if you lived in Noah's time, there was nothing for you to remember because you didn't live. But that story certainly was carried with those people, and they needed a reminder. Passover was a reminder for the children of Israel about what God had done for them. An amazing, amazing story of what God had done for them. The Sabbath day itself was a reminder for all of creation. You remember the story about the 12 stones that Joshua set up when the children of Israel finally became a nation and crossed over the Jordan into the Promised Land. They set up 12 stones, and not sure how long they lasted before they got carried away, but those stones were a memorial for them. Now, the most important memorial, guess what, that God set aside for us is this one right here. This is one we're about to partake of. Jesus told us to do this. This is something we do. We don't just remember. We don't just look at something. We don't just put it on a calendar. This is something we do to remember. And we do it every week. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. But how do we remember? You know, we weren't there. It helps if you were there. We weren't there, but thanks to God that He gave us His Word and the Holy Spirit to help us to make this experience real. When we partake of the bread, we remember Jesus' body that was sacrificed on the cross. Let's pray. Our Holy Father, we are thankful for this memorial that's been set aside for us. And we pray, Father, that each of us can help to keep this memory, and that it remains vivid to us as we recall the sacrifice that Jesus gave for us. In his name we pray. Amen. And of course, when we drink of what we call the cup, we remember Jesus' blood. And I think if we were there, if we had been there and we had seen it, we would never have forgotten what we saw. The blood that literally poured from his side. And we know that blood somehow atones. It somehow washes our sins away. What an amazing gift from God. Let's pray. Father, and as we continue, we also pray that we reflect on this cup and the blood that it represents, and the atoning sacrifice of Jesus when he gave that blood. In his name we pray. Amen. Currently using the box for our offering, but I wanted to just say a word and help to remind us that giving, in a sense, is, it sort of turns the table on us. When we focus here in the Lord's Supper on Jesus' sacrifice, that giving is our opportunity to sacrifice and to just recall that If our giving to God doesn't sacrifice anything, what is it worth? And I pray that we all take seriously this great opportunity that God gives us every week to give. And I just want to leave it there and have you think about that.
I know
that my Redeemer lives and ever prays for me. I know eternal life he gives, from sin and sorrow free.
Prepare. Let us all bow together. Our most gracious and loving Father, how great Thou art. Father, we are indeed so thankful that we have this opportunity to gather around Your throne this morning with our brothers and sisters to thank You, to praise You, to worship You. And Father, we are so grateful that we have this opportunity that we can come here and do these things and honor You. Father, we pray for those that lost their lives 20 years ago. Father, we are still hurting from that disaster. Father, we pray You will comfort these. We pray, Father, that they will seek Your comfort. And Father, we thank You for Your Son who paid the ultimate sacrifice for us. Father, we give thanks to You for this opportunity we can come together to worship You and to hear Your word proclaimed. Father, we pray that You will give Joe the thoughts today that will perhaps stir someone's heart to come to You, to accept You as their Savior. And Father, we pray for our country. We are in such disarray, so much hatred going on in this country. Father, I pray that we can somehow stop all this, that we can come to love one another, to help one another, to do those things that You would have us to do and that we should be doing as Your children. Father, be with us this day. Help us to walk the straight and narrow path. And forgive us, Father, when we fall short of Your expectations. We ask all Your blessings, Father, and we pray these things in Your holy name. Amen.
Minister for the junior high and high school, and I'm currently hosting the Bible Hour for the pre-K and third grade. And I've had a lot of questions recently about how it went, and it was, I believe, very successful. Very little tears. nobody broke any bones. we had a good time. I really did, and my cup's overflowing with joy. I mean, it was a good time. Ironically, this morning we talked about service in the high school class and what that means. And, you know, sometimes it is intentional. You have to take the time and effort to go out of your way and help others. And so I like that my kids can join me over there. I'm very blessed that they're at that age where they can participate and help serve and learn more, hopefully, as well, and continue to do so. So I encourage, if you have a pre-K through third grade, you're welcome to come over there and drop your kid off. And I can, if you're a visitor, I can meet you and discuss the needs of your child and make sure that we arrange that. So it's good thus far, and I want to continue to do that. So until we get into a pattern and a rhythm, I may come up here and announce that we're going to have that Bible Hour. So if you have kids, if you want to make your way over there, we'll have that set up. It's at room number 7. And I'll have some kids helping me as well. the high schoolers did challenge me. They said, well, we can do that by ourselves. I'm like, well, I'm not quite there yet, but I may take them up on that challenge one of these times. no, but it is fun. I really enjoy it, and I appreciate the opportunity to go over there and do that. If you have that calling, if you want to ever try to serve and try it, please let me know. We can always have you test it out. We don't have to sign a contract to do it on a weekly basis or anything like that, but we like to see people participate in that as well. So if you have that calling and you want to try it out or help me out, you're more than welcome to. I enjoy the company. But so I'm going to go ahead and get that started here in a little bit while we're singing. So if you make your way over there, if you do have little ones, we'll get that started. All right. Thank you.
Let's all stand. And let's follow the children. No. Let's stay here and continue our worship as they have their worship. I think that's such great, great ideas. I care not today what tomorrow may bring, in shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord I know ruleth o'er everything, and all of my worry is vain.
Like I need to offer a disclaimer just for a few moments before get into the message. I did something I shouldn't have done several weeks ago, so it's my fault, and I apologize for having us do the portables. I hate those things, I'll just tell you, the portable communion units. So that's entirely my fault that we went back to those. So I'll readily be the fall guy for that, okay? That was, in my mind, a knee-jerk reaction to our pause about certain things around here. So I said, well, we probably better put those out the next Sunday after we did that. So the elders subsequently told me we weren't intending to stop regular communion. So anyway, that's on me, so I apologize. Next Sunday, I say all that to prelude to say we will have the regular communion back next Sunday. Yeah, don't everyone cheer at once. But because we're going to not only pass the collection plate at the regular time, the regular collection, to follow up a little bit on what Charles said a moment ago, that is very important. And then we're going to have at the shepherd's time, we're going to pass the plates again for the EEM special collection. So what I want you to keep in mind with what I just said is please, please don't say, oh, it's EEM day, I'm just going to transfer what I'd normally give to the Salado church family, to the ministries here, I'm just going to move that to EEM. Please don't do that. We would urge you, please, to not do that. The EEM is just to be a special, if you have it, to set aside for that cause. It is important. It is vitally important to get the word out to people who don't have Bibles. But ministries here are vitally important as well. So please remember that and prayerfully consider, because, by the way, our giving has been consistently good through these recent times. Okay, I'll just tell you that. Y'all may not normally look at the board out there. We post every week our weekly contribution. Some of you may watch that. But anyway, just a disclaimer there and word about what's coming next week to be prayerfully considering what you'll do in those things. In the spring of 1940, the German army was plowing their way through France despite the opposition of not only French but 300,000 British troops. U.S. had not entered this war at that point, obviously. And finally, the Germans surrounded and they trapped the Allied forces, most of them, at a little town called Dunkirk on the northern edge of France. Maybe you've seen the movie and know what's going to happen next. But it appeared the Allied forces were either facing annihilation or going to have to surrender. And eventually, through a miraculous outpouring of courage, the British managed to organize an amazing flotilla of hundreds of little ships that evacuated most of the Allied forces. But before that happened, at one point where everything seemed utterly hopeless, a British officer sent the following message, condensed in three powerful words. But if not. But if not. At the time, it was a strong message of courage and ultimate hope that the British would stand defiantly against the Nazis and the belief that somehow God would provide a way through the dark night. But even if he did not, the officer's words indicated there would be no giving in to the enemy. There would be no surrender. A newspaper article later, many years later, in America, an article recounting that story, went on to explain the background to the three-word message, but if not. If you prefer your readings that are done on the screen every week in King James, you would know what I'm about to tell you. What the article said was, but if not, came straight from the King James Version of the Bible in Daniel chapter 3, verse 18. As Daniel's three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, faced the fiery furnace in that chapter, they refused, if you remember in the story, to bow down and worship the image the king had set up. Instead, they declared their trust in God and determination to worship Him alone, regardless of the potential outcome. So let me set the scene for you a little bit more. In actual chronological order, most scholars agree that the king's dream that's recorded in Daniel 4 really happened before the events that we're talking about today in chapter 3. If you wish to turn your text, we will be in Daniel 3 today. In our Bibles. But that what happens in 4 really happened before what we read in chapter 3. And you remember in that dream that Daniel interpreted that the head of gold, that multi-metalled image that he saw in Nebuchadnezzar saw in his dream, the head of gold was representative of King Nebuchadnezzar. And so the consensus is very likely the king's image on this colossal statue. And what this amounted to was a loyalty test for those who wanted to continue living in his kingdom. And I mean that quite literally. To continue life, you were going to honor, you were going to worship, you were going to bow down to his representation on this colossal statue. Now, for the three young friends, it was a battle of the gods, so to speak, in a sense for them. Would they remain faithful to God's first commandment to their ancestors? You shall have no other gods before me. And the second one, like it, you shall not make any graven images or bow down to them. That's what this was about for them. You see, these young men never lost sight of the crucial issue in front of them that day. And by the way, the crucial matter was not deliverance. Now that ended up happening for them, but that was not the core issue here. The issue is worship. 11 times a word that's translated into our English, worship, was used in that short little chapter. And 5 times the word for serve, as in serve a deity. I think God was sending a message here, don't you? 16 times references to serving or worshiping a deity here. God was sending a message through Daniel to his people and to the rest of us who would overhear this story from a distance. The issue is worship. Will we remain faithful and true to the one true living God, even in the face of opposition, without wavering, without bargaining, as if we think we can somehow leverage our goodness? We don't have any goodness to leverage God for anything, to get a good outcome, or else we'll stop believing. True faith does not work that way. It's always simply an issue of who are you going to obey? The one who can threaten yet have only the power to have physical consequences against you? Or the one who can threaten, who loves you, who has proven that through the sacrifice of his son, but who has the power to withhold eternal life if we lose faith or if we leave the faith? That's a pretty easy decision when you think about it. So with that in mind, we hear, and I'll read the King James Version of Daniel 3, 17 and 18. The three friends said this, "If it be so," referring to if you throw us in the furnace, "our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thy hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." By the way, I wanted to put up here, this is just several examples of the type of structure. These are different sampling images of brick kilns. Very prominent in Babylon in that day, how they got their brick. It was fired in these kilns. You can see the example of size with that man standing on top of the one there on the left. These would have been fueled by coal. If you cook with coal, you understand that makes a very, very hot fire. And there's reference to that in the, not to coal itself, but how hot the fire was in the story, that it burned, as you remember, even those who put the three young men into the furnace. You see, three important things were going on here in this moment. The friends acknowledged God's power to save, no question about that in their minds, but yet Secondly, they were not presuming on him to do so. That was entirely his choice. And thirdly, the only certainty they knew, or the only certainty they had in their minds, was that they were going to hold true to the worship of the one true God alone. When that commitment is made early on, like it was for these men, the decision of what to do in times of crisis, it's not a crisis. There's no internal debate because the decision's already been made. Remember early in Daniel, this is not the first crisis they'd faced. Early in Daniel was the crisis of, are we going to honor these false gods by eating food that's been, you know, devoted to them? Or are we going to honor our God by keeping to the dietary regulations that He has imposed on us? You see, they'd already been making these decisions about, is it God or is it these false gods? This was not the first time these guys faced this issue. It likely was not the last time. This is the last story in Daniel that we have of these three, but likely it wasn't the last time they faced this. Daniel faced it, you remember, later in the story. Will I continue to worship the one true living God as I've always done, or am I going to capitulate? Am I going to give in and compromise what I typically do because of a king's edict against it? And we know what he decided there. These three had made their decision. It simply waited to be verbalized. As these three verbalized their confession of faith, their statement of faith in front of this vast audience of all types of officials and dignitaries. And by the way, scholars have pointed out, it's almost comical how many times you hear the repeated list in Daniel 3 of all the different civil officials and all the different instruments. Kind of like if you're a puppet of the kingdom, whenever the instruments go off, you'll automatically, just kind of like they were expected to be automatons, you will bow down, kind of thing, to something that was made, that was fashioned. It's really comical in a sense when you think about the background to this. Well, you remember what happened next. Nebuchadnezzar was furious, publicly embarrassed that these three foreigners held out and refused to fall down before the 90-foot-tall image he'd set up somewhere in the region of what we call Baghdad, Iraq, today. And yet he gave him one more chance to recant and worship. Discretion would have said, let's give in on this one, because this was not a faith decision which everything was neatly tied up. There was the one big variable. God might choose to intercede for them, but He might not. They would not presume on Him to do so. Nevertheless, regardless of that, they stayed with their predetermined commitment. I prefer verse 18 in the NIV. But even if He does not, referring to rescue, even if He does not, we want you to know, O king, we'll not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you've set up. We're encouraged by, you know, their faith in the all-powerful God and His ability to save. But the real bottom line is that phrase, but even if He does not. Their knowledge that God was able was balanced by the fact that for reasons unknown to them, He might choose not to. They were still willing to accept that outcome as well, without debating it, without arguing or complaining or asking why. They put no conditions on their faith in that moment. And that's what I'm wanting you to see today, that God wants us to see in this text of Daniel 3 a conditionless, a nevertheless kind of faith. What kind of faith is it that at every turn has to know exactly what God is going to do, and that, by the way, His action will be in our favor? Otherwise, we won't we won't believe. Is that faith? That seems to violate the very definition of faith, the evidence of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. But let me give you a typical, not across the board, but this is generally a typical 21st century recounting of our story. The typical response would have been along the lines of, well, you know, if we're 100% sure that God will deliver us, then we'll refuse to bow down and we'll be thrown in the fire and rescued and everything will be swell. But if there's even a smidgen of a chance that God is not going to come through, then we'll just go ahead and bow down and get this over with. Is that faith? Saying that God has to obey our every wish and solve our every problem before we believe is not faith. That's called bargaining with God. In fact, it's very close to extortion. Extorting God, actually. As I read my Bible, faith does not work that way. Paul seemed to address this in Romans 8:24. He said, hope, which is very close in its meaning in line with faith in this story, hope that's seen is no hope at all. For who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. Think about this for a moment. What would the world be like if Christians received from God everything they ever wanted? How messed up would that world be? Believers would outlive non-believers by centuries. Christians would have no aches and pains. Every business venture would be successful. Everyone's homes would be beautiful. Get real. Think about how that would undermine the entire God-man relationship, where people would come to God not because of genuine faith, not out of real love, not out of understanding that they need to turn from sin so that they can live, but simply to receive all the fringe benefits. The faith of the young men in our text today was not in signs or wonders or in any assurance of rescue. It was simply in God. I love the little essay by Elizabeth Elliot. If you don't know that name, she was widow to Jim Elliot, the martyred missionary whose story is told in the movie The End of the Spear. She says it well in a little essay entitled, Nevertheless, We Must Run Aground. You may remember, if you know Acts, where that title comes from. She wrote this, The story of Paul's voyage as a prisoner across the Mediterranean tells how an angel stood beside him and told him, not to be afraid in spite of the storm in which all seemed lost, for God would spare his life and the lives of all with him on board the ship. Paul cheered his guards and all the fellow prisoners with that word, but he added, nevertheless, we must run aground on some island. It would seem, she goes on to say, that the God who promises to spare all hands might have, quote, done the job right, and saved the ship as well, and spared them the shame of having to make it to land on the wreckage that was left. The fact is, he did not. Nor does he always spare us. Heaven is not here. It's there. If we were given all we wanted here, our hearts would settle for this world rather than the next. God is forever luring us up and away from this world to Himself and His still invisible kingdom. We will certainly find all that we long for. We have got to be aware that we not get swept up into the health and wealth gospel that so many cling to and so many preach in this world that says, for the believer in God, all trials and troubles will be swept away, that to the one who sincerely believes, everything in their lives will work out right, and if not, well, That means you just don't have enough faith. I pray to God that none of us in this room have ever said to someone who's struggling, well, you just don't have enough faith. And if you've ever said that, don't raise your hand, okay? Because shame on you if you have. Faith doesn't work that way. We're never promised that. In fact, just the opposite. We're promised if we stand up for Jesus and stand out for the Lord, we will have trouble in this world. Notice that even though God graciously chose to rescue these three men, they had to go through the fiery furnace. You notice that? You'd think He'd have done it right, don't you, and not even had to have them go in there. But He did. Those who believe the lies of the world about faith set themselves up for a fall. And I've seen people do it. I've seen people leave the church because they've set themselves up for a fall. They've listened to the world. And then they've come to conclusions when God doesn't act as they expect. That, well, He's either irrelevant or uninvolved in men's affairs, or He's angry with me for something, He's unfair, or He's just ignored me for my lack of visible faith. That's a horrible thing to do to anyone. To make them live in a false premise, a distortion that promises a stress-free life and a God who will do what He's told. Faith is not putting God in a box. During a particular stretch of time, 6-year-old Rachel would pray with her daddy every evening for Miss Pat and Joshua. Miss Pat was her Sunday school teacher, and Joshua was her brother. Her teacher was afflicted with cancer, and Joshua, her brother, had been diagnosed with something called Sanfilippo syndrome. Through surgery and chemo, her teacher went into remission, but Joshua's condition was genetic, and it would one day be terminal. One night, she was pondering all this with the honesty of a child. She asked her daddy some questions. She said, God healed Miss Pat, didn't He? Yes. He did. God loves Miss Pat, doesn't He? Yeah, He does. Then came the toughie. You know what's coming next. Doesn't God love Joshua too? Her logic was flawless, wasn't it? He loves my Sunday school teacher, and He proved it by healing her. So if He loves my brother, He's going to heal him too, right? Children are not afraid to ask those kind of questions. Of course, we ask them too, maybe not out loud, but we ask those kind of questions. We have those kind of thoughts. How do we thank God for healing one for whom we pray and still praise Him when He doesn't heal another for whom we pray? I hope we can be enlightened as we remember the grand scheme of things concerning God's love for us. He demonstrated it for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The supreme expression of love goes far beyond any temporary healing we might receive from an illness in this life or temporary prosperity in this life. It is that God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son to die for us. He was willing as Father to share our pain and our grief. And the Son was willing to participate in it personally. And so we remember, despite the pain, that in the cross and empty tomb, we have unshakable testimony that God's love is for us and His abiding presence will always remain with people of faith. Remember that in the midst of the fire, in that furnace, the three friends were not alone. You remember there was a fourth, looking like a son of the gods, the king said. Well, the dad answered his little girl, "Yeah, Rachel, God loves Joshua too. Jesus died for Joshua too, and even though God may not heal him now, one day he will. And just like Jesus, Joshua will one day be raised from the dead, never to die again, and we'll all live with God forever. One day God will heal everyone who trusts in him. But even if he decides not to now, we still praise him because we know one day he will." Moses' successor, Joshua, said basically to his people at the end of his life, "Even if you will not, I and my household will serve the Lord." Job said, and we're going to look at Job next week, by the way, "Though he slay me, yet will I hope in him." Even our Lord Jesus said, "Nevertheless, Father, not my will," as he begged for possibility of a different outcome in the garden, "not my will, but your will be done." Back to the text quickly in Daniel 3 and their statement in verse 18. While Daniel 3 is a rescue story, yes, that's true, really at the heart of it is a statement about obedient faith. And the model held up before Jewish exiles in Daniel's day, or Christian exiles today, or people of any age who have suffered or are suffering on account of faith in the Lord and His cause, that true faith just obeys. That's it. No bargaining, no presuming on what God might or might not do, just living by and being obedient to the truths we've been given in Scripture. If we live by that kind of faith as those three did, the gates of hell will not be able to stand against the Lord and His cause. Notice the faith we're about to sing about. I'm going to ask Gaines to go ahead and get his note and make his way up here. Notice, faith of our fathers. It's in spite of dungeon, fire, and sword. May we model that kind of faith in front of our friends and neighbors and those who need to know the Lord Jesus. Let's stand and sing about it together.
Faith of our fathers
living still, in spite of dungeon, fire, and sword. Oh, how our hearts beat high with joy whenever we hear that glory. Faith of our fathers.
faith of our fathers. Good morning. It's been a wild few days for most of us. It's been very trying in lots of ways. It's being emotional. It's been painful. But I would suggest to you this morning, it's been good for us to remember. I appreciate all the more what Charles had to say before communion today, but indeed these last few days have caused a lot of folks to remember and to re-examine some things in life today. Hopefully, and we need to pray, that the memorial observed yesterday, commemorating the tragic attack of September 20, September the 11th, the year 2001. I debated whether to even say anything about this morning, and I guess it probably shows. Emotional and trying and painful, I would describe my experience. And though I did not know anyone personally, I do not know anyone personally who had loved ones, family or friends, to die in that event. I felt like, having watched a lot of television yesterday, that I shared that feeling, though, of loss. And I trust that you may have done the same. It helps us to remember. And indeed, we have. Several things have been mentioned this morning that we need to be mindful of. Joe mentioned several things. One thing that was not mentioned, I don't believe of anyone, is that we learned earlier today that our brother Frank Brown had left this life. Frank died overnight, last night, peacefully in his place of residence. He had for a time been in that place of residence, away from his own home. He died peacefully, knowing that he was very near and looking forward to it. And I thank God for Frank, and I think one of my hopes would be that I could leave this world in much the same way that he did. We need to remember Frank. We need to honor Frank. He was among us when I came here 16 years ago, and he's been here. If the doors were open, probably he'd be on that back row here in this midsection. We will not forget Frank, I'm certain. I wanted to share that with you. Many of you have had already the email message that had to do with his passing. More will be said and more will be learned in days to come, but remember Frank this morning. In the bulletin, there will be a note or two that you need to pay particular attention to. One has to do with the Body of Christ banquet that's scheduled for the 19th. Nope, the 21st. Tuesday the 21st. The banquet will be held at the for the Body of Christ fundraising occasion. The arrangements have been made and reserved have been two tables seating a number of people. Some of you have signed up and some of you haven't that may yet want to be included. But if on that evening, Tuesday the 21st, you'd like to join the group from our family here that will attend that banquet, Body of Christ is something that we have supported for a number of years as a church, one of many churches in this area. But the Body of Christ Community Clinic has been very, very well received by the community and recognized to be a work of Christian people like we are. The 19th, Tuesday. I'm sorry, the 21st. I wasn't prepared to get up here and say all this morning, was I? I don't usually keep many notes, but this note says very clearly, Tuesday the 21st. The EM Eastern European Missions special contribution. Joe has mentioned, and I'll leave that be next week. Also, the Sunday, though, the 19th, from 2 to 4, the volunteer training session that has been scheduled will be on. If you'd want to be involved in children's ministries, this work has been one that we've had growing for a time. There will be a training session, though, next Sunday afternoon for those who would seek to be of service in the children's ministry area. Amy and Mary are the two that will be directly involved. If you have questions, if you'd like to sign on yet that you have not, we'd encourage you to do so. We can use some help. Though we don't have all that many children at the moment, we desire to have families with children, and we look forward to, as we prepare even now, to bring up our own children in knowledge of our Lord Jesus, but to be prepared to share that with others as they may come our way. So if you want to be of service in children's ministry area, see what your schedule might permit you to do on that afternoon between 2 and 4. 2 weeks ago, we talked about the concerns related to COVID virus. You may recall we at that time had just learned that two of our members here had been found to be infected by the COVID virus. We at that time suggested that we need to be considerate and be respectful of those who were more vulnerable among our number, who were at greater risk for infection by the virus. We suggested that we return to an obvious effort to avoid the spreading of the virus, and ask you to prayerfully consider the wearing of masks in the building here, in the presence of those who might be at greater risk than we ourselves feel like that we are. We talked about distancing, and we have no tape on the benches yet. We once did that, of course. You heard talk about the communion being served from the table next week, and I think that's all for the better. We've all enjoyed liberties of the past month, 6 weeks, whatever it's been now. We've enjoyed those liberties that seemingly are threatened by what we know is going on right now in our world, having to do with COVID virus. Thankfully, we can report today that the two people that were found to be infected by the virus 2 weeks or more ago have recovered. There's no concern there any longer. We also, though, are aware of at least two cases, two families actually, of our number are quarantining at home right now dealing with COVID virus. It's out there. Virus is still with us, and we need to be very, very straightforward in dealing with it. We again this morning would ask you to consider, things have not changed a great deal. The overall status of the COVID spread in this area has been renewed for a period of time with the opening of schools, all the more a risk. And we still have many people here who I feel like are at greater risk. And you know who you are if you're among them. I would ask all of us to consider again, in the interest of showing our love and our consideration and our respect for those who are perhaps more vulnerable to the virus than we ourselves may be, that we be a people known to be unified in our love for one another, our consideration and acceptance of one another as to what may be best for the whole. Please, I want you to understand, no one likes a mask. No one likes to take communion out of a plastic cup. Distancing is difficult. We're accustomed to shaking hands and hugging. We miss that, and we've enjoyed the liberty the past several weeks that perhaps now we need to be a little more cautious about. In the presence of those, though, who feel to be more at risk, we would ask you to consider, do what you can do to avoid the spreading of this horrid virus. Let's show our love for one another. Let's be united in this. And if nothing else, I think we might find hope even now in all this, that God knows what's going on. And as I believe I said on this occasion 2 weeks ago, God is still much aware. And I trust and I pray that He will use whatever we may be asked to endure here, He will use it to serve His purposes. And indeed, something good will come out of all that we've been through. And even as the 9/11 memorial brought to mind that people were unified more so, more together after the event than before, I believe that after this we'll be stronger than before. I believe there will be an end to it. I would ask you to pray that God indeed will intervene. Unconditionally, we would ask God to intervene and spare us these things. Also, that He would bless, that He would bring about complete recovery to those who now are engaged in this battle with the virus. You've heard enough of this, I'm sure, but please, overshadowing the question and even the debates we sometimes find as to what we ought to be doing or not be doing, above and beyond that, be considerate of one another, show our love for one another, even as we've been called to be of that mind as members of the body of Christ. As I said before, I'll say again, we love you all. Every one of us needs to love one another with a pure heart fervently, according to the Scripture. Now, let's show that we're there. Let's see that we're there. Be careful. It's out there. Would you join me now in prayer? Holy Father, we bow before you now, acknowledging that indeed you know everything that's on our minds this morning. You know what we have experienced in this time together, and we thank you for that, Father. We ask you to bless us now as we conclude this service. Bless us as we leave and go our separate ways, that we might be mindful of what we've done and what we've said, that we might remember the experiences of this day. We're mindful, Father, of the death of our friend and brother, Frank. We know, Father, that there were those who mourn more than even we could this morning his loss, and yet we understand and we know that Frank was ready to leave this world to join eternal. Bless those who mourn, Father. Comfort those who mourn. Draw us together and unite us that we might together remember Frank. Father, we know that you have purpose in everything, and we ask you to help us to see, to understand, and even beyond our understanding, help us to acknowledge that your purpose will be served. We ask you, Father, to use the experiences of this day and those days that led into today, that as people remember, that there would be response that would be serving your purpose. Guide us, Father, to be of open mind, acknowledging completely and yielding to your judgment, your wisdom, as to what we must face. As we often pray, Father, we ask you to help us to endure what we must. But spare us the worst. Thank you, Father, for hearing us today, for blessing us with your presence and your power today, and help us that we might recognize daily your presence in our lives and find peace. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Would you please stand? Time is filled with swift transition.
Not on earth you can stand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Oh, to God's unchanging hand. Oh, to His hand, to God's unchanging hand.